This little girl with a big voice redefined what it means to be a superstar.
There is no singer that compares to Mariah. She is the greatest voice of our time.
A bona fide pop diva whose string of hits eclipsed Elvis, Michael, and Madonna.
She's had 18 number ones. She sold 200 million records.
You just need to say that first name, and you know she's one of the biggest stars we've ever seen.
Mariah Carey!
At just 18, Mariah was thrust into the spotlight, taking the music world by storm.
I thought, I don't know who this girl is, but she is unbelievable.
Mariah Carey.
Vision of love.
Over 20 years later, this dynamic diva has earned a place in music history.
She's at a different playing field than everyone else.
She's a major star, an amazing icon.
But a difficult childhood.
They had problems because they were biracial.
A marriage with more than its share of control issues.
Abuse has several categories.
And the pressures of stardom would exact a heavy price on Mariah.
There's only so much you can take.
But when everyone counted her out, Mariah Carey fought her way back.
She came out swinging, and she made the greatest album and the biggest song in her career.
Mariah is one of those kind of people that you have to make a bet. Don't ever bet against it.
By the end of the 1990s, Mariah Carey had become the most successful recording artist of the decade, racking up 14 number one hits. But with that success came a slew of new demands, which would seriously test Mariah's mettle. 2001 found a Mariah Carey who was not only expected to deliver on a contract with Virgin Records worth over $100 million, but was also staring down the barrel of the now infamous flop-to-be, Glitter. The seams were starting to show.
She had a lot of pressures in a lot of aspects of her life. She displayed very erratic behavior.
Something had to give. And some observers believe that moment came on July 19th, 2001, during an unscheduled and unhinged appearance on MTV's TRL.
What's
wrong? You see, every now and then, somebody needs a little therapy.
Yes, I understand that.
And today is that moment for me.
What's wrong?
I think it was very telling. She sounded exhausted. She sounded pretty lost. And I think at that point, she really was.
The episode came to a head the night of July 25th, when Mariah's mother made a frantic 911 call seeking medical help for her daughter. Shortly after, Mariah was admitted to a hospital, having suffered an emotional and physical breakdown. Questions about her hospitalization and state of mind left people wondering if Mariah Carey's career was over. How could someone who seemed to have it all suffer such a precipitous fall from grace? It was a troubling first misstep in a career, indeed a lifetime, of paid dues, hard work, and remarkably high grace notes. That journey began on March 27, 1970, when Patricia and Alfred Carey welcomed their newborn daughter Mariah into the world. They found their baby's name in the song They Call the Wind Mariah from the musical Paint Your Wagon. As an opera singer and vocal coach, Patricia's work ensured that music permeated the household. And along with Alfred, an aeronautical engineer, Patricia learned singing wasn't simply second nature to Mariah. She had a gift.
She tells this story that she was doing Rigoletto, and I heard her singing over and over this one part, and then one time she did differently, and I corrected her in Italian and sang it to her, and she said she like stopped in her tracks like, huh? You know, how does this little girl, you know what I just said in Italian? And that's when she was like, okay, she has a very good ear. Let me, you know, make sure I nurture this.
Mariah's gift amazed her mom, but sadly, it didn't shield her from certain harsh realities in her daily life.
It was an interracial marriage in the 1970s. There was still a lot of racism.
He was black and Venezuelan. She was white and Irish. They had problems because they were biracial.
One of my earliest memories is being in kindergarten, and I drew my father, and I was using the brown crayon. I suddenly heard these two young kindergarten teachers like snickering and laughing, and I was like, you know, really sensitive always, so I was like, what, you know? And they were like, you're using the wrong crayon. Why are you making your father that color. And I was like, that's what my father looks like. And I learned that people were uncomfortable with it from a very early age.
Mariah has spoken numerous times of the troubles that her parents had in terms of their house being vandalized, their car being vandalized, their dogs being poisoned. So there was a lot of tumult around them, and it affected the marriage.
The sometimes relentless persecution by their community added a considerable strain to Patricia and Roy's marriage, which had its share of pre-existing internal issues.
Mariah's parents were a study in contradiction. Her father was a very intellectually, almost anal in his approach to things. The mother was more carefree and open, obviously being a singer. She offered up something in Mariah that her father could not.
These external and internal stress factors chipped away at the union, and the marriage ended when Mariah was just 3 years old. Mariah's 13-year-old sister, Allison, went to live with her father, while Mariah stayed with her mother and older brother, Morgan.
I moved 13 times throughout my childhood. My mom, she always rented houses, and we didn't have a lot of money. So sometimes we lived in no particular place at all. Like, we didn't necessarily have a place to live, so we would stay with her friends or things like that.
There was one constant in Mariah's often tumultuous childhood: music. It was a passion which her mother encouraged and nurtured.
Mariah tape recorded us singing all the time. She would take it to her mother. Her mother would give some feedback. She would coach us, she'd listen. Her mother was very much present and very involved as well.
She taught me how to sing. She taught me how to harmonize.
I guess when she was about 4 years old, she really showed an interest in singing. In fact, she never stopped singing.
Ever since I can remember.
While Mariah lost herself in song, her connection with her father gradually slipped away, the result of too many moves and too little contact.
When she started moving around with her mother, she really just lost touch with her father. She has often said that she never had a problematic relationship with her father, there just wasn't much of a relationship.
As Mariah lost touch with her father, so too did her relationship with big sister Allison begin to fade.
Her sister was much older. They didn't have a whole lot in common.
When Allison was 15, she got pregnant, and she and her husband dropped out of high school. And that pregnancy really scared Mariah because it showed her that somebody was, you know, in her own family was making the wrong choices and was having to, you know, really alter her life.
It was a very difficult thing to see. I think what it did for me was provide me with an inner strength, something I knew that I didn't want to be.
Mariah began to channel the domestic chaos and the ensuing emotions, putting her deepest feelings down on paper.
So I started writing songs, like, around, I guess, eighth grade. It was like my release, and it still is.
While she worked on her writing skills in private, Mariah the singer hit the pavement, looking to cut her teeth on any available gig.
When I got to be like 13 or 14, I was doing some demos for people around where I lived. They would like be trying to sell jingles or whatever, and I had like a commercial voice to them.
This first taste was all Mariah needed, and while most girls her age were spending time in class, Mariah had her sights set firmly on a career in music.
I would basically, you know, be working in the studio till like 3 a.m. and then come back, and you're not gonna get up at 7 and go to school.
But school wasn't very important to Mariah. She was nicknamed Mirage by her classmates because they never saw her.
By the age of 15, Mariah was routinely traveling to New York City to visit her older brother, Morgan, whose job as a personal trainer gave him an in to the music business.
My brother lived in Manhattan and knew a lot of different people in the music industry because he was training people at that time.
Morgan was very supportive. He had aspirations at that point of being a music producer himself. So he was very into what Mariah was trying to do.
Morgan introduced Mariah to songwriter Gavin Christopher. Christopher was an established player in the industry, working with legendary acts such as Curtis Mayfield, Herbie Hancock, and Grandmaster Flash.
Her brother Morgan was my physical trainer. One day he knocked on my door, and I opened the door, and there was Mariah. She was like 15 years old. I took her in the studio, and the minute I heard her sing, I walked up to Morgan, and I said, "Man, your sister's gonna be the biggest star in the world."
The two began collaborating on some early songs, with Christopher thoroughly impressed not only by Mariah's voice, but also her talent as a songwriter.
I got a couple of things on tape, and I took them to a couple of people at record companies, because I was signed to Capitol Records. And I told them, I said, if y'all don't sign this girl, you're going to be sorry. You better sign her. And nobody bit. Nobody bit.
Christopher also introduced the young hopeful to his bandmate, Ben Margulies. And with this connection, Big Brother Morgan had unknowingly set Mariah's career in motion.
I could tell, like, right away that she had a really special quality in her voice, and I just said, maybe we should get together and work on some songs. She says, well, I've got some ideas, and I said, well, I've got some ideas, and that's kind of like how it all started.
Those ideas would grow into what would become some of the biggest hits of the 1990s, thanks to a chance meeting between Mariah and a man more than 20 years her senior. By the time Mariah Carey was 3 years old, she already knew what she wanted to do for the rest of her life: sing. As a child of a broken and interracial home, growing up in New York in the 1970s was difficult for Mariah and her siblings, Morgan and Allison. But in spite of the chaos and instability, Mariah was able to follow her dream, thanks in large part to her older brother, who put her in touch with local players in the music scene. And by age 16, she was making weekly trips from her home on Long Island to New York City to record demos with composer Ben Margulies.
When I was in school, driving back and forth, I wrote a lot of songs with him, yeah. And that's where I did my first demos, in his studio.
I had set up this little sort of makeshift studio at my father's cabinet factory. While I was working on a track, she'd already be sitting there putting lyrics together, and it was just a quick process. I mean, very often in one evening, we'd write a song, record the whole demo, and be thrilled by 7 a.m., you know.
The thrill of recording convinced Mariah to make a permanent move to Manhattan when she graduated high school in 1987. But for a young woman with few connections, New York would prove to be a difficult experience.
I was living on the Upper West Side, running around like a straggler, scrappy kid, eating like a bagel and an iced tea. That was my meal for the day, you know, living on like a dollar.
While life in the big city was a challenge, it did afford Mariah the opportunity to continue working with Margulies. And the two clicked.
We wrote a ton of stuff. Someday, Vision of Love, Love Takes Time. There was just a sense about what we were doing that it was going to happen.
Armed with a solid demo, Mariah worked hard to shop her music. But with no industry connections, the singer faced one rejection after another. After a year working as a waitress and coat check girl, Mariah finally caught a break when she landed a tryout with singer Brenda K. Starr, who had a top 20 hit with the song I Still Believe.
They said, one of the backup singers just quit or something, can you come try out for this job? I was all nervous, and I had to sing her song. And after I got done, she goes, what, are you trying to steal my job? After that, she was just like always really cool to me, like trying to get other people to listen to my demo.
This friendly campaigning became a crucial turning point for Mariah when Starr invited her to a party for high-powered industry execs Jerry Greenberg, Walter Yetnikoff, and Tommy Mottola.
We walked in, and she says to Jerry, this is my friend Mariah. She writes all her songs. She goes to hand him the tape, and Tommy Mottola was standing next to him, takes the tape out of his hand, grabs it, and puts it in his pocket. And I was like, confused, because I didn't know who any of these people were, but I was like, that guy's not going to listen to this tape.
But Mariah was wrong. Not only did Mottola, who was chairman and CEO of Sony Music, listen to Mariah's tape, he was wowed by what he heard. Believing he could make her a star, like he'd done with Hall & Oates, John Cougar Mellencamp, and Carly Simon, Mottola sought out the would-be pop star.
I got a message from him on my machine, and was just like, yeah, Tommy Mottola, call me back, bye. And I was like, what?
During that same week, I had found a contact directly to somebody way up high at Warner Brothers, and he immediately flipped out when he heard it.
And they wanted to use a couple of my songs for the movie Lean On Me, and it was this, you know, whole thing, and I was excited about it.
We immediately had back-to-back meetings with Warner Brothers and Sony. You had Walter Yetnikoff, you know, pounding his fist on the desk saying, this is going to be the biggest record of all time. And it was nuts.
Warner Brothers had offered Mariah $300,000.
Tommy threw $50,000 more into the pot.
Essentially, it ended up becoming a bidding war because they both wanted it. Mariah had connected with Tommy, and he just had a very sort of New York way of doing things that was, you know, it was convincing. It ended up being probably one of the biggest record deals of the decade at that point.
With Mariah signed to Sony, Mottola backed the singer with his best producers and musicians in an effort to make her debut a hit.
Tommy Mottola had just been appointed the president of Sony Records. So clearly, you know, he had a lot to prove with this first signing.
They wanted big producers that could really make a kind of very commercial sound.
There was a whole different caliber of producers and musicians that she had access to. They wanted me to work with a lot of different people, and I tried a lot of different stuff.
Mariah was very unsure about it.
The process took a long time, but it was a learning experience.
An experience which would set the tone for Mariah and Mottola's working dynamic.
Once Mariah signed with Sony Records, Tommy was very hands-on. He basically was guiding every conceivable element.
Tommy did everything. He was the mastermind. He did everything, and everyone on both sides of the equation respected him, so you let him do his thing.
With Mottola pulling the strings of his new protege's career, Mariah Carey's self-titled debut album was released on June 12, 1990. Though the entire team hoped for a hit, Mariah kept her own expectations in check.
I wanted to be famous, and I wanted to be on MTV and have success and do all this stuff, but it was like, I just want to hear my song on the radio.
Not only did Mariah get her modest wish, but Vision of Love would become a smash, hitting number one on the pop, R&B, and adult contemporary charts.
I never thought that was going to be my hit song. To me, it was an album cut. It was an obscure kind of song. It wasn't what was, like, popular at the time. It was a little different. And I guess that's why it worked.
It would stay at number one for a combined total of 9 weeks, and by August of 1990, it became a certified gold record. Running parallel to her musical success was Mariah's personal connection with Mottola.
Her relationship with Tommy basically grew out of them being partners in music, and out of the music and out of him representing a form of stability that she says she's never had. You know, it really filled something inside her.
While the pair might have successfully kept the details of their personal relationship quiet, their professional collaboration was quickly becoming the talk of the industry.
In the music business, sometimes there's a little bit of magic. And I think that Mariah Carey came along at the right time with the kind of people she had behind her at her record company. I can't imagine that she wouldn't have blown up.
Mariah Carey.
Vision of Love.
Mariah's debut album would go on to chart 4 number one hits, sell 6 million copies, and win 2 Grammy Awards. Just 3 short years after arriving in New York City, Mariah Carey had gone from wannabe pop star to one of the top-selling female artists of 1990. But when it would come time to record her follow-up, critical backlash, weak sales, and a battle for creative control would threaten to undo everything she'd worked to achieve. By the spring of 1991, 21-year-old Mariah Carey had scraped her way from struggling wannabe to music's breakout sensation. Her self-titled debut had sold 6 million copies, spawned 4 number one hits, and garnered 2 Grammy Awards. Fueled by her success, Mariah immediately went to work on her second album, Emotions.
I had this work ethic that I imposed upon myself that was really, really harsh. Because of fear, really, you know, of losing something and going back to where I started from. So I got on this thing where it was like, do another album, one for every single year.
This drive extended to an attempt by the star to regain some of the control she felt she'd surrendered on her debut album.
The thing is, my demos were really good. Some of those demos were better than what the record ended up sounding like. Maybe because it was simpler, there wasn't so much production.
But despite her misgivings, it was clear Mottola was running the show.
He was definitely somebody who was used to being in control and used to being the boss. The first video that she did, he didn't like that she was a little too sexy in it, and that's one of the reasons why the video was scrapped and they filmed another video.
If any creative disagreements happened, it was like, because as a young person, I wanted to be able to express what I liked.
Despite, or perhaps because of the sparks created by their creative tug of war, Mariah and Mottola's romance blossomed. And once Mottola's divorce became final, spilled into the public eye, the news made headlines.
Here we have an ingenue, very sexy, very pretty and talented, and the man behind the curtain who's pretty much pulling the strings of her career and making her a star.
It was sort of scandalous. He was 20 years older than she was. He had been married for 20 years and had children.
That's definitely good gossip.
With the media focused on Mariah's relationship with Mottola, Emotions was released on September 17, 1991. The title track would become Mariah's fifth consecutive Billboard chart topper, making her the first artist to achieve this feat. But reviews were mixed, as some critics began to wonder if there was any substance behind the voice.
And on a critical level, there was a sense in which, you know, her singing was almost more of an athletic gift than something that she brought a soulfulness to. You're more impressed by it than you are moved by it.
Reeling from the critical backlash and a 50% drop in sales, Mariah also felt increasing pressure from critics who continued to question her natural singing ability when she once again refused to tour.
There was speculation as to whether she really was that great a singer. You had Whitney Houston out there also, you know, people would be like, well, she's no Whitney. The idea was that she was kind of this studio-made star.
Tiring of critics' insinuations that she couldn't sing live, Mariah booked an appearance on MTV's Unplugged on March 16, 1992.
Unplugged was really like the first concert I'd ever done. And people were waiting to hear, like, can she do this? So that's why there was that type of pressure. I was nervous because I have so many high notes hit, and it really requires me to isolate myself and just be on vocal rest and not speak and be like in a well-humidified room and sleep as much as possible because people want to come hear me sound right. I'm not going to go out there and be a mess.
Mariah's performance was far from a mess. The result was so powerful that Sony released Mariah Carey Unplugged as an EP on June 2nd. It would go on to sell 6 million copies.
She had a lot riding on her shoulders, but once she got out on stage, she blossomed. She was able to prove unequivocally that she had the goods. It was calculated risk, but one that obviously paid off with tremendous dividends.
That same month, with their romance in full bloom, 23-year-old Mariah married 43-year-old Mottola in a lavish ceremony in upstate New York.
Tommy Mottola and Mariah Carey were a great show business couple in a very classic mold. There was a fairy tale aspect as well. Their wedding was incredibly glamorous.
The guest list was just like the who's who of Hollywood and the music industry. I mean, Barbara Streisand was there, Billy Joel was there, Robert De Niro was an usher.
There was so much media coverage, and Mariah in this beautiful white gown, like Princess Diana.
She had this Vera Wang dress that was $25,000 and this 28-foot-long train where it required 6 people to carry it. I mean, she had 50 flower girls and cost around $500,000. So it was really Mariah's initiation into this life of luxury.
The couple moved to an opulent mansion in Bedford, New York. It was a vast departure from the life she'd known most of her life.
There was a huge jump between where she came from to where she ultimately ended up. This incredible home in Bedford, 65 rooms, a lake, horses. The name of the house was Storybook Manor.
Having been a working class girl and grown up in not the most stable environment, to having this incredible opulence and this life of celebrity for a girl who was in her 20s, you could tell it was something she was still adjusting to.
On August 31st, 1993, Mariah released Music Box, her third studio album, and the first in which Sony allowed her the role as lead producer. Music Box would become Mariah's biggest selling album with worldwide sales of 32 million. Perhaps bolstered by the success of the first album she could truly call her own, a rift began to develop between the singer and the man who is credited with launching her into superstardom. At a personal and professional crossroads, Mariah was about to find herself, for the first time in her life, on her own.
It got to a point where I had to go.
By 1997, Mariah Carey had become one of the top recording artists of all time. Barely 7 years into her career, Mariah had recorded an amazing 11 number one hits. She was also married to Tommy Mottola, one of the wealthiest and most powerful men in the music business. But the Cinderella story was beginning to unravel. And when the Sony Music Chief's controlling nature left her feeling both creatively stifled and personally trapped, it took its toll on Mariah.
I was very, as you know, sequestered when I first started out. I wasn't really allowed out of the house.
Whatever abuse?
Abuse has several categories.
You've been emotionally abused.
Emotionally, mentally.
Is it true that you would head for a cheeseburger at McDonald's and you'd be getting phone calls on your cell phone? Where the heck are you going?
Basically, yeah. It got to a point where I had to go.
3 years of this situation was enough. Mariah told Tommy she was leaving and moved out of their Bedford home. The couple announced their separation on May 30th, 1997. The divorce would become final a year later.
In all honesty, I never really believed in marriage because I never saw an example of one that really worked. It just wasn't the right thing because it put this other sort of pressure on things. Because, you know, you're also the wife of the head of the thing. So you have to be like super appropriate at events. Not that I can't be, but to do that when you're on stage and in public and in private and always, it's just like very, very draining and confining.
Her marriage to Mottola at its end, Mariah now faced professional uncertainty. Still contracted to his label, Mariah found herself in the vulnerable position of having her ex-husband pulling the strings of her career.
There was a lot of speculation about where her career would go and whether she would leave Sony. When you're divorcing the head of the label, you know, I'm sure it was a complicated situation for both of them.
Having claimed personal independence, the singer fought hard to assert even more control over the production of her next album, Butterfly. Collaborating with the likes of Diddy, Q-Tip, and Missy Elliott, Mariah infused this record with more hip-hop and R&B than her previous releases. It was a vast departure from the pop music that helped Mottola make her a star.
The record company wanted to keep me very down the middle, and I always wanted to do things a little bit more, you know, the urban side of things. Like, I know how to do both.
She wanted to move, as all artists do, in a different direction musically, and I'm not sure everybody there was probably down with it.
Mariah's newfound creative confidence fed rumors that the pop star was turning into something of a diva.
No matter what you see or read about Mariah, there's always the word diva thrown in there somewhere.
She wasn't somebody who had built up a tremendous amount of goodwill. There's been a sense in which Mariah Carey is thought of as difficult.
How do you even explain that? Okay, so I care about the way I look. I care about what I wear. I agonize over my music. Is that too much to ask that everything I do be right?
I definitely thought going to be a big entourage, which there was, and she's going to fly in on the private jet, which she did, and she's going to have the, you know, bunch of cars and limos and stuff, like a caravan, and she did, and all of that was exactly as I thought, until it was just the three of us in the room together, and then all of that was stripped away, and it was about the artistry and the work ethic. It blew me away.
Upon the music video debut of Honey, the first single from the album, it was clear that Mariah had not only drastically changed her sound, but her image as well.
When Mariah was under Tommy's management, he was very controlling about her image, and so she very much came on as like this girl next door. And then after the divorce, she kind of came out as this like sexy glamazon.
Well, I actually did a joke on stage and said, oh, Mariah must have found the U-Haul storage that Tommy had hidden, because it was like all these clothes that were Tommy Mottola's ultimate nightmare.
Mariah was always gorgeous, obviously, but she began to embrace her beauty around the Honey video.
She was free.
Yes, she was.
And that whole time period really was very rewarding and validating for me, you know, because it was like, look, you know, I can do something different. I don't have to always have my hair in curls and a black dress on enough already, you know?
Along with her new freedom, romance found its way back into Mariah's life.
After she divorced Tommy Mottola, Mariah Carey was involved with other high-profile men. She was involved with the singer Louis Miguel, with Derek Jeter.
Mariah and Derek Jeter had a lot in common. They're both biracial, so they hit it off pretty quick. And unfortunately, the romance played out in the glare of the gossip spotlight. There was photographers everywhere they went. When Derek Jeter went into a slump, it was Mariah's fault. They're both very private people. What doomed the relationship was they just got tired of being in the public eye.
Her romantic life on hold, Mariah went back to the studio to record Rainbow, her seventh and final album for Sony. After racking up over $1 billion in earnings for Sony, Mariah was now free to leave Tommy Mottola's empire and sign with a new label. But when Virgin Records offered her over $100 million to leave the safe confines of the only work environment she'd ever known, the stress and uncertainty would push Mariah Carey to her emotional breaking point. By the close of the 1990s, Mariah Carey had unseated Madonna as the female recording artist with the most number one hits. With the release of Rainbow, her seventh studio album, the singer decided to leave Sony and sign with another label. Free from Tommy Mottola's influence and the protective and at times restrictive confines of Sony Music, the 30-year-old Mariah would soon be flying without a net for the first time in her life.
She was really wanting to prove that she could get another number one hit and that she could have, you know, the same success that she had had at Sony Records. Mariah went to like Elektra Records, Arista. They basically asked for bids from every company.
In early 2001, Mariah got her chance, landing a record-breaking deal with Virgin Records worth over $100 million.
It was important for Mariah Carey, after she got out of her deal with Sony, you know, to really present herself as an artist in control of her career and a person in control of her life. Mariah Carey at that point was behind the wheel of the car. A company like Virgin then had, you know, a tremendous financial incentive, you know, to make Mariah Carey a success.
Virgin's first step in marketing the new and improved Mariah Carey was a film titled Glitter. It was a pet project of Mariah's that had been bouncing around studios for several years. She was responsible for both recording the soundtrack and playing the lead role in the film. This workload, in untested waters no less, had Mariah working harder than ever.
I was working, working, working. I took it on my shoulders and said, I'm gonna work every single minute of the day. I don't care, I'm gonna make this happen.
She would fly in after a day of shooting or editing, come directly to the studio, work all night, get back on a plane and fly wherever she needed to go to do whatever else she needed to do, which is totally incredible and crazy at the same time. It would be impossible for most, and I don't know how she did it.
By the summer of 2001, however, the demanding schedule began to take its toll. And when Mariah appeared unannounced on MTV's TRL, her infamous visit shocked viewers and left the media speculating about her state of mind.
What was shocking about it wasn't that she just showed up. What was shocking that she was pushing an ice cream cart and was passing out popsicles and ice cream to the fans. She started stripping off her clothes and was wearing very, very teeny shorts and top, and she was rambling things, what sounded like incoherent statements.
She She had just gone through that divorce. She was trying to prove herself in many ways that were personal and professional. And I think that was very traumatic for her in a lot of ways.
She was in a transitional period as a woman and as a pop star, and it was very, very sad to see.
Mariah's downward spiral came to a head on July 25th when the star's mother made a frantic 911 call seeking medical help for her daughter. Later that night, Mariah was admitted to a hospital having suffered an emotional and physical breakdown.
A lot of us have those kind of breakdowns, but Mariah, unfortunately, was having hers on MTV. I think her fans actually were very worried about her.
If you work as hard as she worked from the early 90s for a solid 10 years, you have to take a break. You have to.
Working like 21-hour days for 2 months in a row, I just got exhausted and I really just collapsed because it was too much.
She just needed a break. She needed to rest. She needed to be a human being.
Mariah's hospital stay pushed the glitter premiere from Labor Day to September 21st.
I overworked myself and I paid the price, but my fans got me through it, and that's why I'm here tonight.
Critics skewered the film. The Village Voice called it a heart-wrenching debacle and infinitely mockable.
The first time I saw Glitter, I used the phrase, unfortunately my seat was facing the screen, all those kind of things, because she was in over her head.
She was ill-equipped to handle a starring role, especially in a movie with a hackneyed script and predictable plot turns. It was almost universally derided.
Budgeted at $22 million, Glitter tanked at the box office, grossing just over $4 million. The movie soundtrack was also a disappointment, with Mariah failing to chart a number one hit for the first time in her career.
Glitter just seemed like a complete creative failure for Mariah Carey. And it was one of the first times we really saw her not come through as an artist. And that was very hard for her, and understandably so.
The two-tiered failure took Virgin Records by surprise. With more than $100 million on the line, speculation mounted that Virgin execs were seriously considering cutting ties with Mariah.
It was a tremendous embarrassment. And there was this kind of sense of like, look, this person's unpredictable and we don't really know what she wants to do and she's driving us crazy. There was a sense of, you know, she's not going to be able to pull it together.
In January 2003, the label forked over $28 million to buy out Carey's contract. In total, Mariah received $49 million for less than a year under Virgin's roof.
They were basically paying her this money to kind of go away. And while that's obviously financially a really great deal, I think that it was very embarrassing for her and very humiliating.
The break with Virgin would leave Mariah Carey without a label for the first time in her career, a career many believed was at its end.
The failure of Glitter could have ended her career. She was doing crazy things, and her stuff wasn't selling. I mean, that's a lethal combination. But I think she handled that the best way she could, you know, which is, you know, you kind of take a little time off, you straighten yourself out, and then you figure out what you want to do next.
Mariah's time off would be short, however. Just 4 months after being sacked by Virgin, Island Def Jam signed the free agent to a new deal. Mariah's first record for her new label, 2003's Charm Bracelet, stayed in the top 20 for only 3 weeks. It was yet another blow to the superstar's faltering career. Mariah's personal life was faring no better. Shortly after reconciling with her father, Alfred, he was diagnosed with inoperable cancer.
It was very strange because I had just started to understand different elements of my father that I never understood as a kid, and started to have deeper conversations with him and really started to ask him questions. It was really nice to be able to put everything out on the table and just talk.
Although he had a difficult time showing it, he was very, very proud of Mimi. And when he got sick, we learned some things that surprised us, like that he had almost all of her press clippings and her music. I think it was really touching to her.
He was amazing through the whole thing. He really was fighting hard. It was a very tough thing. I guess you just have to keep moving forward and celebrate the person's life.
Mariah took a break from recording, but professionally, the timing was less than ideal. Just 4 years after leaving Sony, Mariah Carey had gone from one of the hottest acts in music to what many were starting to view as a has-been.
She had fallen from that great place, and she was being questioned.
Who looked more strong and amazing and, like, announcing herself as, like, you thought, what, I was dead in the water? What, you were worried about me? You're embarrassed for me? Because I'm all on MTV handing out popsicles? You thought I had a problem? No, I'm fine. I'm straight, I got this, don't worry about it.
But Mariah's winning streak didn't end there. A new chapter in her personal life began when she attended Fox's Teen Choice Awards and met actor-comedian Nick Cannon.
Every time somebody would ask me about my celebrity crush or who I would love to marry one day, I would always say Mariah Carey. People would be like, yeah, right. Ain't no way in hell you gonna be able to marry Mariah Carey. But I kept saying it like every interview, and I said it so much that she heard how fond of her that I was.
On the Teen Choice Awards, they were giving me an award. He gave me the award, and then he just stared at me, and he didn't really talk. And I said, thank you for all the nice things you've been saying about me, because every friend I had would be like, man, that dude Nick Cannon really likes you.
I mean it, the truth, give me a chance. And then the entourage just whooshed her off.
Then we got together again in, you know, a couple years later, and we got a chance to talk, and we connected on a lot of levels.
The pair began dating in the spring of 2008 when Mariah hired Nick to star in the video for her song, Bye Bye. They were married a mere 6 weeks later in a sunset ceremony at Carey's estate in the Bahamas. That same year, Mariah's single, Touch My Body, became her 18th number one hit, leaving her second to only the Beatles. In 2009, Mariah decided to take another shot at acting, playing a tired social worker in Precious.
Mariah Carey was amazing in Precious. And it's not just that she sort of uglied up for the role, and anybody can do that, but she brought honesty to the character.
Within all that glamour, within all that glitter, Mariah found a tired social worker and made us believe it. And I realized as an actress, she had come into her own.
In October of 2010, Mariah and husband Nick Cannon announced that they were expecting a child due in the spring of 2011.
Mariah would be a fabulous mother. She's so nurturing. She cares so much about other people. She'll put other people way before she'll put herself sometimes. And that's a quality that everyone doesn't have.
Over 20 years into her career, Mariah Carey has survived a business that manufactures and discards stars with regularity. But through the painful ups and downs, Mariah fought her way back time and again, ultimately cementing her legacy as one of the entertainment industry's biggest and most enduring names.
Mariah Carey has shown a lot more resilience than I think anybody thought she had at the beginning.
With all due respect to, you know, the other one-named divas, if you will, Celine, Christina, I think Mariah will be the one that defines my generation, without a doubt.
She is the greatest. There is no singer in contemporary music that compares to Mariah. She simply has more talent than everyone else.
You know, she's somebody who's determined to do it on her own terms and to stay around until, you know, she decides that she doesn't want to do it anymore.